And so we're going to continue our series, though, of defeating the giants in your life. And today we're going to look at the giant of pride. The giant of pride. Do you know the dictionary puts it this way? It's the quality of having an excessively high opinion of oneself or of one's importance. I'd kind of tweak that just a little bit and say it's the quality of having an unhealthy opinion of oneself or one's importance. Because, you know, if we take and we walked over to the mirror that we're portraying over here and we see the, you know, we look at ourselves in the mirror, I think time after time after time after time, it's the unseen giant we face in our lives. Because it's the one between our, it's behind our eyes. It may be in our mind or down deep within our heart. It's an unhealthy of opinion of ourselves, of one's importance. The writer of Proverbs in the 11th chapter of Proverbs in the second verse puts it this way. When pride comes, then comes dishonor. But with the humble is wisdom. And so what I'd like for us to do over these next few moments is I want us to look at pride. The cause of pride, but not just the cause of pride. What is the cure of pride? And we're going to walk through a number of examples throughout Scripture where we see pride was obviously part of what took place that either helped folks drift away or reject God or come toward God. And we're going to look at a number of things, and we're going to look at them quickly, and I'm going to encourage you to write some of these passages down because we're only going to scratch the surface. And so I'm going to give you some homework this next week. Dig a little deeper into these passages. See how these passages are speaking to you as it is spoken to my heart over these past few weeks as I have sat and I've dwelled on these things, and God has really worked in my life in a strong and mighty way personally. But let's look at the cause of pride, because I think it comes out of the 16th chapter of Proverbs, verses 18 and 19. The writer of this proverb said, "Pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before stumbling. And it is better to be humble in spirit with the lowly than to divide the spoil with the proud." You see, so if we're going to look at the cause of pride, there's two main determining factors that I think give us an unhealthy opinion of ourselves. And the first is we focus on self. We focus on us. We do what I like to call we navigate. Now, you know what a navigator is, don't you? It's someone who looks at their belly button. And so they navigate. And so they're always looking at themselves, always not knowing where they're going or where they're going to wind up. And so it's easy to walk and drift off the path that God wants to put us on. And so there are three ways that we focus on ourselves that is unhealthy. And the first one begins in the third chapter of Genesis. Is where we distort the Word of God. We distort the Word of God. And I think this is important because when we drift away from what the Word of God says, and we don't grasp it in its totality, then it's easy for us to distort and draw some prideful conclusions within our own walk. Because there in the third chapter, we see the fall of man. See, God had given Adam and Eve some instructions. When he said in the second chapter, he said, "The Lord took the man and he put him in the Garden of Eden to cultivate it. And the Lord commanded the man, saying, 'From any tree of the garden you may eat freely, but the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, because when you do, you shall surely die.'" Well, in the third chapter, we see the snake come slithering in. And he approaches Eve. And he was crafty, because Satan doesn't come with a full frontal assault. He gets us to doubt some things in our minds. And he goes in the third chapter and he says, "You shall not eat from any tree of the garden." Really? Why would God want to hide that from you? And the woman said to the serpent, "From the fruit of the trees of the garden we may eat." And then the third verse she says, "But from the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said, 'You shall not eat from it or touch it, or you will die.'" She distorted the Word of God at that point in time. That is not what God told them. He said, "Do not eat of it." Because the moment we want to add something to the Word of God, we begin to distort it. Because when God says what God says, He means what He said, and nothing else needs to be added to it. And it boils down, will we believe it or will we not? Do you really honestly believe you can make the Word of God better by changing it or adding to it. Whoa, that's what she did. Come on down in the verse 6. In verse 6, when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took from its fruit and ate it, and also gave it to her husband, and he ate. You see, when you distort the word of God, you're going to see things wrong. And when you see it, it's going to affect you. It's going to affect your senses. It was the eye. Man, it was desirable. That's not wrong. But what she went on and did with it, that was wrong. Because if she believed what she had said, she wouldn't have even touched it. She reached out and she grabbed it and she touched it. Can you imagine what was going through her mind at that point in time? I wonder really what God meant by that. What do you think he meant when he said, I would surely die? Would that mean the moment I take a bite, I'm going to kill over and croak? Cease breathing? I really don't know. Man, all this other stuff is good. But man, this is the best. But I've touched it and nothing happened. You know, so what I added to the word of God didn't matter. And it affected her mind. It affected her logic. It affected her thought process at that point in time. Because now that she distorted the word of God, she could allow her mind to run in many different directions. It affected her will, her desire. Because now the moment I believe she put it in her hand, she had a desire. I've got to take a bite. Is it nearly as good as it looks? I'm going to tell you, there's one thing that I do not like anymore about social media or about the internet. It's a site called Pinterest. People think they're doing you a favor by posting on their page all of these delectable recipes, and they cook them in 30 seconds or less. And you go, man, I want that. Can you imagine? That's exactly what was running through Eve's mind at that point in time. Her desires had changed because she had distorted the word of God. Her emotions had been impacted. I just feel like I need to eat this. I just feel like maybe what God told me wasn't correct. Oh, and we tend to forget that following God is not a feeling, but it's a choice. So she distorted the word of God. But not only when we focus on self do we distort the word of God, This self-focus does not wait on God. It does not wait on God, because in the 13th chapter of 1 Samuel, we see Saul, who had become the king, because they had to have a king. He was head and shoulders taller than everyone else. He seemed to be a mighty warrior. And yet he was getting ready to go to battle. As he was getting ready to go to battle in the 13th chapter of 1 Samuel in the 8th verse, he had waited 7 days according to the appointed time set by Samuel. But Samuel did not come to Gilgal, and the people were scattering from him. So Saul said, bring to me the burnt offering and the peace offering. And he offered the burnt offering. As soon as he finished offering the burnt offering, behold, Samuel came. And Saul went out to meet him to greet him. But Samuel said, what have you done? And Saul said, because I saw that the people were scattering from me, and that you did not come with the appointed days, and that the Philistines were assembling at Michmash. Therefore I said to the Philistines, will come down against me at Gilgal, and I have not asked the favor of God. So I forced myself and offered the burnt offering. And Samuel pretty much looked at him and said, man, you acted like a fool. You see, this self-focus that causes pride does not wait on God. And because it does not wait on God, it gives us this feeling, we must act now. I got to do something. Don't I have to do something? Come on, God, you said you were going to show up. Where are you, God? Let me remind you of this. God may never be early. I promise you, he'll never be late. He'll always be on time. He's not going to be early. When you need him, he will be there. But pride will tell you, you don't need to wait on him. You got this covered. It's okay. You know what to do. And we tend to forget it's not about what we do. It's whose we are. God cared more about Saul in his sheer presence in his sheer being than he ever did what Saul was going to do for him. He wasn't waiting on this sacrifice. He was waiting on the obedience that was going to come by Saul waiting. And I'm going to tell you right now, I do not like to wait. And God has worked on me severely. And so my word for the year that God has used over and over and over in my life is the word wait. I mean, the psalmist in the 27th chapter of Psalms says, wait on the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Yes, wait on the Lord. You think Saul could have used that at that point in time? Or was he too busy worrying about himself? What am I going to do? I'm losing control. People are leaving. They're going away. I don't know what to do next. He had a wrong focus. The enemy, it's coming. I can't trust. God, you told me to wait on you. I got to fight this battle myself. There are things in my life. I'm telling you. Let me be just a little transparent sometimes. There are things in my life that's going on. And I'll look at God and God says, I got this, Bill. This one's my battle. And I'll start out and he'll say, wait a second now, Bill. I told you I got this. Do you trust me? Well, yes, God, I trust you, but let me help a little bit. No, he says, wait on the Lord. And you see, when we think of waiting in our culture today, we think of it, man, we're being passive. We're being weak. But Jeremiah, in his book of Lamentations, in the 3rd chapter said, the Lord is good to those who wait on him, to the one who seeks him. That right there tells us that if we're to wait on God, this isn't a passive activity. This is something that we're going to be involved in. We're going to be actively pursuing God in this. And Saul ceased pursuing God because he was more concerned about winning than he was about being faithful. And so his focus was wrong. He couldn't trust. And you can't trust your feelings at this point in time. Following God is a choice. And Saul got prideful. He had an unhealthy high opinion of himself to say, I know what to do. I know what to do. Now, the next element when we focus on ourselves probably is the one that's going to be tough for us to swallow, because we will disregard God almost in an air of our own religiosity. Truth of the matter is, I didn't look that up. I don't know that it's a word, but if it's not, I think it should be. In our own self-spirituality, we will disregard God. And one of the best examples of that's in the 18th chapter of Luke. In the 18th chapter of Luke, when Jesus had been teaching his disciples on prayer, and he talked about the unrighteous judge, and then, but how to approach God the Father in prayer. We see this in verse 9 of the 18th chapter. He also told this parable to some of the people who trusted in themselves. Whoa. And they were righteous and viewed others with contempt. He said, two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. And the Pharisee stood before, the Pharisee stood and was praying this to himself, God, I thank you that I am not just other people, swindlers, unjust, adulterers, even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I pay tithes on all that I get. But the tax collector, standing some distance away, was even unwilling to lift up his eyes toward heaven, but was beating his breast and saying, God, be merciful to me, the sinner. You see, when we disregard God with an air of religiosity, our prayers may be elegant, but they're empty. Has there ever been a time in your life and you just do not feel like your prayers get above the ceiling? Are you doing a little self-check at that point in time? God, why am I asking what I'm asking for? Why am I asking what I'm asking for? Why do you do what you do? Why do you ask what you ask for? James in the 4th chapter in the 3rd verse says, you ask and you ask amiss. What is your motive? Why are you asking what you're asking for? And then not only that, when you disregard God, you begin to compare yourself to others, not to Him. You know, that way I look pretty good. The Pharisee here said, man, I pray twice a week. I tithe everything all the way down to the nth amount. I make sure it's just right. Oh, God, look at me. I'm so great. I'm not like him or the adulterer or all these others. I am the greatest. And thus we disregard God. Because we don't think we need him, because we are doing so much for him. We equate our activity with a relationship with God. I teach Sunday school. I'm a deacon. I sing in the choir. I help in the clothes closet. I help in the food pantry. I go on these mission trips. Look at me, God. I do, I do, I do, I do, I do, I do. And what we tend to forget is to look at God and say, God, I thank you, and leave it at that, because the Pharisee didn't. He said, I thank God that I'm not like. And see, what we see here, that the cause of pride comes from a focus on self, whether we distort the word of God, or we do not wait on God, or we disregard God in our own churchiness. It doesn't matter. We have an unhealthy opinion of ourselves. When we look in the mirror, we may see, who do we see? And the last thing that I want to see when I look into my spiritual mirror is I do not want to see Bill. I don't want to see him. Because John the Baptist probably said it best when folks come up to him and said, have you heard about this guy named Jesus? Everybody's going to follow him. And John the Baptist said, that's okay. I must decrease and he must increase. Prayer every day. Can I look in the mirror? Can I see less of Bill and more of you, Jesus? I do not want to focus on self. It's a cause of pride. But it's not only the focus on self that's a cause of pride. It's the focus on stuff. On stuff. In 2 Kings, Hezekiah had just been healed. He was a good king. They had had a number of bad kings. He was a good king. And the prophet came to him and God said, get your house in order. You're going to die. And Hezekiah went before God and he pleaded and he begged and he fasted. He said, would you spare me? Because I want to do more for you, God. And he said, yes, I will spare you. I'll give you 15 more years. 15 more years. Well, the word got out that God had healed Hezekiah. So they came from all over to begin to see Hezekiah. And when a group from Babylon came, Hezekiah said, let me show you everything about here. Let me show you all these things that I have in my palace. And the prophet Isaiah came and said, Hezekiah, what did you do? I'm going to tell you, when someone from God shows up and he asks you 2 questions, and one of it involves, what have you done? Just repent on the spot. You may not know what it is, but I promise you it cannot be good. When my wife walks in and goes, Bill, what have you done? Baby, I'm sorry. And my question is, what have I done? And so this prophet came in. He said, what have you done? And Hezekiah looked at him and said, what are you talking about? Where were those people from? They were from Babylon. They were Chaldeans. They were good. And what did you show them? I showed them everything in the palace and everything in the temple. And Isaiah said, you're going to lose the kingdom. Not in your life, but your family's going to lose the kingdom. Those that you showed everything to are going to come back and take it all back with them. And we see this play out. But what does this mean? It means you focus on stuff when you brag more about what you have than more about God. If you can't say amen, say oh me. That's what Hezekiah did. God had just just extended his life and it healed him. And nowhere in the 20th chapter of 2 Kings do we see Hezekiah saying, hey, it's good to see you. Let me tell you what God just did in my life. Let me tell you what God just did for me. Let me tell you how God has just blessed me. Let me tell you what all's going on in my life that I can thank God for. He said, let me show you what I have. Let me show you what I've collected. Let me show you what I've accumulated. Let me show you how successful I am. When you are blessed, do you tell others what you have, or do you tell them about the goodness of God? Man, the cause of pride not only comes from a focus on self, it comes from a focus on stuff. And in the 12th chapter of Luke is probably one of the best passages that describes this. As God has been driving home to them the faithfulness, how much God cares to his followers. And in verse 16 of the 12th chapter, we're going to find out we focus on stuff when we build and create a false sense of security. Because he told the parable, Jesus, he said, the land of a rich man was very productive. And he began reasoning to himself. Oh, he said to himself, what shall I do since I have no place to store my crops? And then he said to himself, this is what I will do. I will tear down my barns and build larger ones. And there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, you have many goods laid up for many years to come. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool. This very night your soul is required of you, and now who will own what you have prepared? So is the man who stores up the treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. He builds and creates a false sense of security. Someone with an unhealthy opinion of themselves is going to value your own opinion more than God. This is what the self-talk is. Do you realize that every day you talk to yourself? I'll admit it. Every once in a while I answer myself, because there's time in my life I need an intelligent conversation. Those of you who know me are going, are you kidding me? But what do you say to yourself? What have you placed in that's going to come out even when you talk to yourself? This guy, I said to myself, man, look at me. Look what I have done. I know what I'll do. I'll tear down these old barns and I'm going to build some bigger ones. One thing that we tend to forget when whatever we have, we know we have it, and we wrap our hands around it so nothing will happen to it. In the same way a closed hand cannot give anything away, it can't receive anything new. And what God has done, and we tend to forget, is that everything as a believer, when God gives something to us, he gives it to us to give it away. Oh, he's given you love? Then don't hoard it, give it away. He's given you faithfulness? Don't hoard it, give it away. He's given you goodness? Don't hold it, give it away. He's given you patience? Go out and practice it, give it away. He's given you joy? Don't keep it to yourself, give it away. We get to give. We get to give. We get to give. That's the only reason God gives to us. We are not to be a stagnant pool, but a stream of living water that God can use as a channel to come in us, to bless us, and go through us to bless others. Because what we see here, this mindset, it may lead to riches, but it won't lead to being rich. It may lead to pleasures, but it won't lead to prosperity. You cannot hoard it enough for God that he can't outgive what you've hoarded. Amen. When you're willing to give it away. And it's a false sense of security because he thinks, man, look at me. I can just take it easy now. And that night God came to him and said, you fool. God's going to bring you home. Now who's going to get it? Now whose will it be now? Huh? a false sense of security. It's a short-sighted vision that does not live beyond this life. You realize everything that God does in our lives is not for now, it's for later as well. We're able to take what God does in our life right now and we're able to bless others with it. But He wants us to begin to enjoy living in His presence as we sung about. Because that's where eternity is going to be. Life does not end when we take our last breath on this side of what we see as eternity. Amen. And so we need to do something. We need to be about something that will outlive our life. When you do something for others, you live beyond that moment and what you did. That's why one of the main reasons God leaves us here and why He brings us into a community of believers like we are is not so we can sit there and say, look at who we are as First Baptist. This community we know as Panama City and Bay County ought to be different because God planted us here to reach out, to touch, to impact, to influence in the way that we live, in the way that we walk, in what we say, and what we do. Because we are the house of hope, connecting people, transforming lives for the glory of God. That ought to be something every morning we should wake up and say to ourselves. See, you say something to yourself. Say to ourselves, God, you've allowed me to be part of the house of hope. Now help me this day to connect people to you, God, by showing them your love. Connect people to others by bringing them into what's going on here so they can experience what we're experiencing. And for one reason and one reason only. So God, you will be glorified. That's my motive. That's my reason. That's my heartbeat. You know, if there's anything that can be put on my epitaph when I pass away, I hope it is. And He glorify God daily. Could that be said? Could that be said? Now, those are the causes of pride. Those are the causes of why we may have an unhealthy opinion of ourselves. What's the cure? If we focus on self and focus on stuff, and that's going to create this within us, this prideful attitude, what's the cure? Then it's focus again. But it's focus on the Savior. That's it. Because we've got to learn, it's not about me. It's not about me. And in the 6th chapter of Isaiah, in the 4th and 5th verse, we see Isaiah comes into the temple and he sees the Lord and he's high and lifted up and rightfully adored. And the moment that he sees it and he realizes this is God, he says, woe is me. I am a sinner. I am a man of unclean lips amongst a people of unclean lips. You see, when we focus on the Savior, we're going to realize not to have an unhealthy opinion of ourselves. We must have a life-changing experience. It's the realization of seeing God. And when we see God for who He is, it's going to impact us. And as it impacts us, we know forgiveness is going to come. Whatever it is. Friends, I've got good news for you. If for some reason you've walked into this room and you do not know why you're here, but you're hurting, you're lonely, you're sitting here and you're saying, Bill, I don't know why I'm here. I feel like I'm lost. It's a day you can be found. You say, you don't know what I've done. There's no way that I can experience forgiveness. I've got good news for you. He has already paid the price for you to be forgiven, and now He wants to know, will you just receive it and forgive yourself? It's the realization of who God is that can bring us to that point. And forgiveness will come and heart change, which will impact your speech, will come about because you will now have something to say. Amen. Because in Isaiah it says, and He took the coal off the altar and He touched His lips and He began to praise the one true living God. We focus on the Savior and we see the truth in who we are. Do you see the truth in who you are? You not only see the truth in who you are, you see the truth in the cost of salvation. In the 23rd chapter of Luke, at the end of Jesus' life, as he gave his life for us, we find the truth in the cost of salvation is the blood of Christ. Because there is Jesus. He had been beaten. The crown of thorns had been pressed down upon his brow. And he stumbled through the streets, carrying the cross to the Skull Hill. And he was stretched out on that hill. And with a hammer and a nail, it was driven into his hands. And the cross was raised up and it was dropped down into that hole with a jar. And to his left and to his right were common criminals. And blood flowed. The cost of salvation was the blood of Christ. And we see the truth. And you know the thing about it is, everybody sees it, but do they see it? As Jesus said, let those who have eyes, let them see. Let those who have ears, let them hear. And we see here in the 23rd chapter, beginning in the 39th verse, as he was hanging on that cross between two criminals, one of the criminals who were hanged there was hurling abuse at him, saying, are you not the Christ? Save yourself and save us. But the other answered, rebuking him and said, do you not even fear God? Since you are under the same sentence of condemnation, and we indeed are suffering justly, for we are receiving what we deserve for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong. And he was saying, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said to him, truly I say to you, today you shall be with me in paradise. Oh, do you see the true cost of salvation? Because it's there for all to see, but do you see it? Do you see it? One set to his side and saw all that he went through and saw him utter out, Father, forgive them, they do not know what they do. And all he could think about, he was focused on self. Jesus, save yourself and get me off this as well. He didn't even know what to ask for because of his short-sighted vision. All he could think of was the here and now. Get me out of this, God. But yet the other criminal looked across and rebuked him, and he looked at Jesus. He says, Jesus, I know you're talking about something beyond what we're experiencing right now. I want to be part of it. I want to be part of it. And that's when Jesus said, today you'll be with me in paradise. Because that criminal understood the cost of salvation. Even though it was at the end of his life, he understood the cost of salvation. So if we want to have a cure of pride, we've got to focus on the Savior. We do that by first of all seeing who we are. Second, by seeing what the cost of salvation to get us in right relationship with God. What it cost this one and only Son. But we've said all of this to get to this point. Because there's some of us in here today. I'm telling you. We're saying to ourselves, man, that sounds good. But I'm in control of my own destiny. I just don't know that I want to believe this. Do you see the truth in the right question? In the book of Acts, in the 16th chapter, there's Paul and Silas. They're in jail. It's midnight. They've been singing praises. An earthquake comes. The ground moves. The bars open up. And finally, the jailer awakes. And he sees every cell door wide open. And he thinks to himself, oh my, they're going to kill me for letting all the prisoners out. And he raised his sword to kill himself. Verse 27. When the jailer awoke and saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul cried out with a loud voice, saying, do not harm yourself, for we're all here. And he called for the lights, and he rushed in trembling with fear, and he fell down before Paul and Silas. And after he brought them out, he said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? The right question. We're sitting here in this life, and we walk these streets, this path that life has put us on, alone. Because there's an empty hole in our heart. We don't even know the right question to ask. We think if I get more education, that'll do it. If I accumulate more stuff, that will do it. If I find me a better partner, that will do it. If I get married, oh, too often two people walk alone and they get married. Now they walk alone together. God wants to move beyond that. God wants to move beyond that. He doesn't want you to walk alone. He wants to walk with you. And so ask the right question and recognize you need a Savior, because life is not about me. Everybody say that with me. Life is not about me. One more time. Life is not about me. The moment we realize that, it will be a life-changing, eye-opening, heart-changing experience. Because then we can turn and ask the right question. Whether we come down here in just a few moments when we give the invitation and grab one of our ministers by the hand, I heard everything that he said, and I've got one question: what must I do to be saved? Or we walk outside these doors and we just look up to heavens by ourselves and we say, God, I do not know everything that went on in there, but I do have this question: what must I do to be saved? Or you're watching by television or over the internet or on Facebook and you're going, I hear what you're saying. Then ask the question. Or do you not want the answer? What must I do to be saved? Because only asking and responding to the right question can cure pride. Because if you do not want a Savior, then you're full of yourself and you got to get it out of there. And only Christ can remove it and replace it with salvation. So ask the question, sir, what must I do to be saved? And realize that God has a purpose for our lives, for every one of us, and that's to have an intimate personal relationship with Him through Jesus Christ. But we have a need. We all have messed up. We have fallen short of the glory of God. We have sinned, so we are separated from God. But God didn't leave us that way. God has a provision. That provision was His Son, Jesus Christ, that we looked at just a few moments ago. And He hung on the cross, lived a perfect life, and paid a price that we can't pay so that we can enter into right relationship with God the Father. That's His provision. And what is our response? It's to ask the question, what must I do to be saved? And then to ask Him to come into our lives, to be our Savior, remove us out. Move us out, and you move in, God, and be my Savior. What must I do to be saved? The only cure for pride. Stand with me and let's pray. Father, we thank You for loving us. We thank You that You loved us enough that when we're full of ourselves and we have an unhealthy opinion of ourselves and we look in the mirror and we can see it, You do not want us to stay that way. And so from the beginning of time, You knew that the fullness of time would come and You'd send a Savior, and His name is Jesus. And so over these next few moments, Holy Spirit, we've invited You into this place. We ask You would continue to move. And there are some that You're dealing with that will need to come to the altar because they've distorted the Word, or they've disregarded the Word, or they're not waiting on You, or they're bragging about stuff, and they just want to get right. There's others that they cannot get rid of pride till they come to the cross. And the Bible says that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. For with the mouth confession is made unto salvation, and with heart you believe unto righteousness. And so the Bible says that if you'll pray this prayer and you mean it from your heart, dear Lord, I know I'm a sinner. Come into my life, forgive me of my sins, and be my Savior. If you say it and you mean it, God does what He promises. He comes in and He saves you. And I'm going to encourage you in just a few moments when Ken and the choir begins to sing that you'll come down and grab one of these ministers by the hand and say, what do I need to do next? Or ask, what must I do to be saved? Because today's the day of salvation. Pride must go for Christ to come in. So Father, over these next few moments, have Your way. May You be pleased. May You be glorified. those who desire to be part of this is their church home, that they'll come and they'll plug in because they want to serve and they want to make a difference. And for those who want to know you as Savior and Lord, may they come. As Ken and the choir sings, Christians pray. Whatever God's calling you to do, you come, and you come now.